Last time we introduced the simplicial homology of a simplicial complex as a subquotient of the singular chain complex. We stated a theorem, namely the inclusion map from singular simplicial chain complex to the entire chain complex of singular chain complex induces isomorphism on the homology. Similarly, the quotient map from the singular simplexes to the ordinary simplicial homology, that will also induce isomorphism on the homology. Together, if you take P inverse composite I star, that will be an isomorphism from the homology of the simplicial homology, whatever you call, to the ordinary homology of the singular homology of the underlying topological pairs. So this has many consequences now. So we will continue the study of this one today. Okay, postponing the proof of this theorem for a while. First of all, the comment that I made last time, I would like to repeat it, namely, when you take a triangulation, the simplicial homology will depend upon triangulation as such. However, once we have established the above theorem, we see that the simplicial homology is functorially same as the singular homology of the underlying space. Therefore, it is independent of what triangulation you have taken. The only thing that we have to ensure that an arbitrary topological space may not have a triangulation. If it has a triangulation, then we can choose any triangulation and then compute the homology with the simplicial homology. So that will give you the singular homology as well. So this has a tremendous application now. So one by one, we will try to recapitulate some of this. The first thing is C dot of KL is defined as a quotient complex of a free chain complex, namely all singular simplicial maps. However, even the quotient is also a free chain complex. So one begins with a choice of an arbitrary order of vertices. Put an order on the vertices, then each n simplex in K, one can choose the non-degenerate singular n simplex given by an order preserving map from delta n to the vertices of K. So that one single thing, there should be only one order preserving map after all. So that will represent all such collection of all such things will represent a free basis for CNK. Okay. So that way we get that CNK is also a free abelian group. If K is finite, then all CNK will be of finite rank also. Okay, in particular, if K is compact, mod K is compact, then we know K is finite. So these are the few things which you have to keep in mind. Moreover, what happens, the boundary homomorphisms are given by just the incident matrices, that is, matrices whose entries are either 0 or 1. You see, So what you have to say is, if a matrix is defined from, if you take a set of bases, say, for n simplexes as alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha n, and for n minus 1 simplexes as, say, beta 1, beta 2, beta m, then whether alpha 1 is, beta 1 is incident at alpha 1 or not, depending upon that, at the alpha 1, beta 1 entry or 1, 1 entry, you will put a 1. If it is not incident, it's not a sub of this one, you put 0. So that 0, 1 matrix, you know, you can put a matrix for information for the boundary operators. So once you put that matrix, boundary operator is completely determined. So this way you can computerize the entire information on the simplicial chain complex in the computer. And if programmed properly in a single minute, in a less than 5 seconds, it will give you the homologies. So this is the way computers have, this is the only way actually computers have entered into topology. Okay, to begin with, sometimes that was done in 80s, but now it has become a huge industry. The process of choosing the order on a K, you have to be cautious about it, because as soon as you choose an order, it is your choice, somebody else may choose something else and so on, functoriality will be lost. Computation, you will arrive at the same thing, no problem. But the functoriality will be lost. So in applying the theories, you have to be careful. Okay, process of choosing an order on vertices, taking strictly increasing sequence of vertex maps, defines a right inverse to the homomorphism phi star from sk s dot of kl to ckl, this is the quotient map. And thereby, ckl as a subcomplex of skl. Okay, however, one should take care to note that this identification is not functorial. You can identify it as subcomplex, but somebody else may identify it as some other subcomplex and so on. So there are problems of that nature. So you have to be careful. We also note that S dot of KL plays an intermediary role from going from CK to SK. You cannot go directly. So SKL to SK, I can go curly S to ordinary S, I can go by inclusion. From curly S to C, I can come by a quotient map. Okay, that's why it's called subquotient of this one. Suppose K1 and K2 are subcomplexes of a simplicial complex K, such that the union is the whole of K. Since any simplex, singular or not, of K is a simplex in K1 or a simplex in K2, because K1 union K2 is the whole of K, and they are subcomplexes. It follows that this curly SK1 plus curly FK2 is the whole of SK. Similarly, CK1 plus CK2 is the whole of CK. A non-degenerate simplex in K will be either inside K2 or inside K1. Otherwise, you don't get K equal to K1 union K2 as subcomplexes. So this is much, much stronger than saying that mod K is the union of mod K1 and mod K2. Of course, it will be. But if I just say that and don't say that K1 and K2 are subcomplexes, then it is not working. Okay, for subcomplex, which is stronger than saying that the total space is union of the subspaces here. Therefore, in a very strong sense, there is a excision here. You see, we needed open subsets and so on, and excision theorem there. You don't need anything. This was the subgroup of this one in general, but it is actually equal in this case. we wanted H star of this one to H star of that inclusion map an isomorphism, but this is actually equal, so H star will be identity isomorphism here. So the beauty is that immediately, without any verifying whether something is excision and so on, it's there already. We can apply Meyer-Vittori sequence. We can apply all the consequences of Meyer-Vittori sequence to whenever you have two subcomplexes spanning the whole of the K. Okay, so this will be very useful now, both of them for curly S as well as the C. So as a striking and very useful information in this result, okay, of equivalence of singular and simple issue homology, the following. Suppose you start with a K comma L, a polyhedral pair. It just means that K is a simple issue complex and L is a subcomplex. If the dimension of K is less than or equal to N, okay, so this is the only condition. We are not assuming that it's finite dimension, finite or anything, but finite dimension, dimension of K is less than. Then the homology of this pair beyond N, namely bigger than equal to H, K bigger than equal to N, okay, they are all zero. So the homology survives only up to the dimension N. And the nth homology is always a free abelian group. Okay. Why it is a free abelian group? Because remember, Hn is defined as some kernel divided by the image. The kernel is a subgroup of a free abelian group, so it is free abelian. The image is zero here because Cn plus 1 is zero. There is no Cn plus 1 here at all. There are no non-degenerate n plus 1 simplices when the dimension itself is less than equal to n. Okay, so this is the beauty of Cnk rather than Snk. Okay, Hn of Kl will be a free abelian group. And Hn of K, this is zero because the Cn plus 1, Cn plus 2, etc., they are themselves zero. Further, if K is a compact polyhedron, that's what I already told you, H star of Kl is finitely generated. Because the whole thing is finite number of cells, you know, the chain complex itself is finitely generated free abelian groups, all of them. Okay, so this information, though it is very easy now, I mean, this is not difficult theorem, this will be very important information. In this context, let us study what is the role of the barycentric subdivision. Remember, barycentric subdivision was used in the simple issue complexes to get the one of the very important theorem, namely simple issue approximation. So let us understand whether barycentric subdivision has any role to play in homology. Okay. So start with a simple issue complex K. And let SD of K denote its barycentric subdivision. This little SD is denotes the subdivision. Now, this capital SD, I am going to define a chain map from C dot to C dot. Okay, this is done inductively as follows. At C naught level, C naught of K is what? Free abelian group over vertices of K. This is a free abelian group over vertices of SD of K. What are the vertices of SD of K? There are some additional vertices. They are all barycenters of various simplexes in K. So they will all be vertices there. So So there are extra vertices here. So from vertex here to vertex here, there is an inclusion map. Extend it linearly to get C naught of K to C naught of SD of K. So this is just the inclusion of the vertices, okay? The vertex set of K is a subset of vertex set of SD of K. So on C naught, we define SD to be the extension of the inclusion map, linear extension, because they are abelian groups over these free, the basis as these sets. Now suppose we have defined SD on Cn minus 1. Okay, then I want to define it on Cn. Now SD is a chain, SD is a abelian group homomorphism. Okay, and we would like to have it as chain map also. First, let us define it as a group homomorphism. Okay, so any n simplex sigma in K, if I define what is SD of sigma, then again I can extend it linearly because Cn is a free abelian group. To define SD of sigma to be beta sigma, this is an extension, you know, you have done this kind of extension, own construction. SD of the boundary of sigma. Boundary of sigma is a chain which is in Cn minus 1, n minus 1 chain. So boundary of sigma is defined by induction hypothesis. Okay, SD of boundary of sigma is defined. So this is a chain now. You extend it by beta sigma to make it a n chain. This is an n minus 1 chain to make it an n chain. So that is the definition of SD of sigma. Okay, so beta sigma denotes the barycenter of sigma here. Okay, inductively, we will have to verify whether this is a chain map. It is a homomorphism, that's what by definition. But I have to verify that it commutes with the boundary operators. Okay, so at C naught level, there is nothing to bother because beyond that, there are zeros only. Okay. So at C1 level, we have to verify starting with 1. So let us just see how it looks like. Okay, at n equal to 1, let us look at one of the edges, E equal to U comma V. Okay, that's a one simplex. We have SD of E by definition is beta E into boundary of E, SD of boundary of E. But SD of boundary of E, remember, it is just the identity inclusion map. At zeroth level, it is just the identity extension of the inclusion map. So it is boundary of E only. Beta of E, boundary of E is V. Beta of E, boundary, the other part is minus E, minus of U. So this is what the definition of SD of E gives us. On the other hand, boundary of SD of E, after taking this one, I have to take boundary. Boundary of this, by definition, look at this one. You know, you drop beta E and write V, then drop V and write beta E, but with a minus sign. Right? That is the way the boundary operator is. Similarly, boundary of this one is U minus beta E. That's a minus sign. So beta E cancels away, what you are getting is V minus C. Okay, so what we have got is boundary of SD of E we have computed. We have to compute SD of the boundary of E. Okay, on the other hand, SD of the boundary of E is by definition SD of boundary of E is V minus U. But at the zeroth level, SD is identity map, it is V minus U. So these two agree. So we have verified that it is a chain map from C1 on C1 to C0. That part is a, is fine, that it commutes with the boundary operators. Now suppose you have done it for n minus 1. Up to n minus 1, suppose you have done this job. Then we can verify it for n. Okay. Let now sigma be any n simplex. Then boundary of SD of sigma is SD of boundary of sigma minus, by this is by definition, I'm first line is definition, okay. minus beta sigma of boundary of SD of boundary of sigma. Okay. SD of sigma was beta sigma times this one. So you first drop beta sigma, what you get is this one. Now you keep this one and then take the boundary of that one. Okay. So now this is same thing as SD of boundary of sigma, but this one is beta sigma as it is. Boundary of SD we have verified is SD of the boundary in the dimension one less. Therefore, it becomes SD of boundary square of sigma. The boundary square of anything is zero. Therefore, this drops out what you are left with SD of boundary sigma. Okay, so that verifies for the N chain now. So what we have got is capital SD from C dot to C dot K to C dot SD of K is a chain map. Okay. All this we could have done on S dot K as well. Okay. There's no problem. But however, important thing to notice here is that SD is not functorial. Okay. Because of the barycenter of taking barycenter operation itself is not functorial. Okay. So what is the functorial essence here? If we have a simplicial map phi from K to L, okay, we have a commutative diagram. When you pass to C dot K to C dot L to C dot of SDK to C dot of SDL. This is introduced by phi dot phi. So the any simplicial map induces a functorial chain map at C dot of SD of K to C dot of SD of L. Whereas it will fail to do that if I take instead of C dot, if I take S dot. So this is the problem. But here it is functorial. Okay. So checking this one will be left to the reader as an exercise for the time being, so that you will carefully go through what is happening here. Now let us continue. What is this good for? This the barycentric chain map SD. Okay. Let tau from SDK to K be a simplicial approximation to the identity map. See, SD of modulus of SD of K is K, is the same thing as modulus of K, is same topological space X. Okay, so there is an identity map. Identity map can be simplicially approximated by just taking any subdivision you can do. All that you have to do is the extra vertex is there. You should send it to the one of the old vertices within that simplicial complex, within that simplex. So such a tau exists. All that you have to do is to take tau to be identity on the vertices of K. But extra vertices will come now. That is, what are the extra vertices of SD of K? They are barycenters of some sigma. The barycenter of some sigma should be sent to some vertex V inside sigma. That's all. There are many choices, but don't go out of a simplex. The barycenter is in the center after all. Just move it onto the boundary, one of the vertices on the boundary. That's it. Okay, such a thing will be a simplicial approximation. Take any simplicial approximation by the very theorem we have. The mod of tau is homotopic to the given map to which it is simplicial approximation. Therefore, in this case, mod tau from mod st of k to k, which is this is these two spaces are the same. This map is homotopic to the identity map because it's a simplicial approximation to the homotopy. In particular, what we get is when you pass to the homology, homology of this and homology of this are the same. And tau star will be actually the identity map. Okay. So this information has something to play with the chain map SD, which is from this here to here, okay, on CK, CK to this one. So what is the relation? That is what we have. Let tau from CSDK to CK be the chain map induced by tau. Okay, after all, tau is from STK to K. If you take C dot to C dot here, you will get a chain map, the chain map independent. Okay, we actually claim that tau dot composite SD is identity map. Okay, so this barycentric subdivision is the right inverse to tau dot, or barycentric subdivision chain map has lots of left inverses at the chain level. The tau dot is one choice. Any simplicial approximation to identity would have given you that. There are many choices for tau dot. Okay, so this also we will do by induction. On C naught, look at C naught to C naught. What SD did? SD just was the inclusion map. And what tau did? Tau was retraction. Okay. All the new things were sent to some old things. On the old things, there was no change. It's identity map. Therefore, on S naught is clear. Okay. Or C naught it's clear. All right. Suppose this equality holds on Cn minus k. Let sigma equal to V naught Vn Vn be a non-degenerate simplex in k. I want to verify tau of SD is equal to identity. That's what I want to verify. Now, what is beta sigma? Beta sigma is the barycenter. Where does it go under tau? To one of these vertices, I am putting it as Vi. I don't know which vertex, okay? Because that depends upon the choice of tau. Then tau dot SD of sigma, this is the right side here, left side here, tau dot composite SD of sigma is tau dot of beta sigma boundary of SD of sigma by definition. But tau dot is a linear extension of a simplicial map. Therefore, it is tau dot of this into tau dot of that, right? So tau dot of beta sigma, we just wrote down it as a Vi. The rest of it is tau dot of SD of boundary of sigma. Okay, why? Because here we have verified that tau dot of SD, it is DABA of SD is SD of DABA. Okay, that's what we have verified by induction hypothesis. Okay, this is equal to Vi of DABA Vi. This is induction hypothesis. Next, induction hypothesis, this is by chain map. So here it is induction hypothesis with tau dot of SD is identity. All right. So Vi into boundary of sigma, I am writing the formula for boundary of sigma. It is minus 1 to the j, summed over j, V naught, Vj omitted, Vn. Okay. Now look at what happens. If j is not equal to I, okay, then if j is not equal to I, then that Vi will be there twice. So that will be a degenerate simplex. So we can throw away all of them in C dot. They are all zero. So the only term that survives is when j equal to I, outside is a vi, inside vi is omitted. So they may be all distinct. In fact, they are distinct. Okay. So, but what is this one? This vi omitted thing is in the ith place. You can put this one back in here by a permutation. But that will make minus 1 raised to I come again as sign. So minus 1 raised to I into minus 1 raised to I will make it sigma. Okay. In the first place, it is just vi. If I put back into vi in this place, then it is sigma. So tau dot of SD of sigma is sigma. So thus, we have arrived at one of the important results here, namely the subdivision chain map induces an isomorphism on H star. Okay, how do you get this one? How do you get this one? Tell me. Because SD, okay, is the right inverse of tau here. When you pass on to the homology, tau star composite SD star will be identity. But we know tau star is an isomorphism. So any right inverse of an isomorphism must be an isomorphism. Okay, at this level, there is no isomorphism as such. Okay, it's right inverse only. Tau dot is not an isomorphism. But when you pass to the homology, tau dot star is an isomorphism being homotopic to the identity map. It's actually the identity isomorphism. Therefore, in any case, the paracentric subdivision, see, this is different chain complex, this is different chain complex. But, and the homology, we have seen that they are the same homology. They are homology of mod k, right? So SD star is actually the identity map in that sense. But right now, to see that this identity map requires a lot of identifications here, what you know is this is an isomorphism. Okay? And it is a canonical isomorphism. Because SD itself, we have seen that, is a chain level map which is canonical, which is functorial. Okay, so we have some exercises here. One of these exercises is to verify that for the last one. Okay, these are not very difficult exercises. I hope you will try them before we proceed further. Okay, so let us stop here today.